In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelled among us, and we beheld his glory, that glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Words like these have been the words that have inspired the artist up through the centuries to portray the face of Christ. Let's go back into some of that history and scripture as the artist speaks about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Appearance was long and rather ugly, and yet the early artist was inspired by the words of Isaiah, where Isaiah spoke about the suffering servant to come. In his 52nd chapter, Isaiah said that this suffering servant, this Messiah, would suffer a beating so that his form would be marred more than all the sons of men. And then in his 53rd chapter, and even now, in the first and early centuries, we see the split Nazarene beard. The 53rd chapter spoke about the despised man, abject among men, a man of sorrows he would be, as if it were a root that would not bear fruit through the seed that was planted upon it or dropped upon a dry ground. There would be nothing about his appearance that would make us desirous of him. If you can imagine the words prophesied by Isaiah, this Jesus would eventually be beaten and battered so that we couldn't recognize him any longer. And these are the very basic scriptural pieces that inspired the early Byzantine artist. Let's now move further to capture the Eastern appearance where it really began. So we see these long features. Holding that for a minute, let's jump the gap in centuries and move from the first through the 11th century to the Renaissance and see the appearance that we generally accept as the face of Christ.
Thank you.
So we see the warmer appearance of the face of Christ, the beard remaining the same from the very first century. What were the words that now move this artist? We can explain that through three paintings: the agony of the garden, the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, and the confrontation before the Roman soldiers. Remember, the soldiers took his clothing off and placed about him the gorgeous robes of a king. They would make sport of him, and they would place this purple robe about Jesus, who claimed to be the king of the Jews, and they would make fun of him. And then they gave him a scepter. But before going into that painting, let's look at the other two. Recently, most of the Christian world celebrated Palm Sunday, where Jesus rode into town on a donkey that hadn't been ridden before, according to prophecy. Jesus, as he would ride into those narrow streets of Jerusalem, a place that any tactician would advise he shouldn't have been at that time, people would throw palm leaves at his feet. And as he made his way through the narrow crowds, he would not only hear hosannas, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and the higher acclamation, hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. But those others who did not believe in this Jesus, he would see the Roman soldiers who would give him mock salutes, and Jesus would answer that from the tree. And as he made his way through, he would hear that beautiful prayer in his own language and in Hebrew as we understand it, the Shema. And those people would shout to him, Rabboni, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echod. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And Jesus would ride into and through that crowd and then cleanse the temple. In the other painting, Jesus in the agony in the garden, we read it about it in Luke 22:44. As Jesus was in that garden, he knew what was about to happen within a matter of hours. This Jesus, born of a woman, as any man or woman is, 8 days after his birth, he would shed blood according to the custom of his parents. But Jesus was born to die. And in that scene, we see Jesus lying there and then praying on a rock. Some of the apostles were not awake at that time. And as he sweat, Luke, the physician, tells us, after the fact, after he had gathered the evidence, Luke wasn't there at that time, that his sweat turned into giant droplets of blood. And that's when he began to die medically. Jesus would then look up into a beam of light, and the artist Hoffman portrays the scene. And Jesus would say to the Father, let this cup pass. Let me out of this moment, but let not my will be done, but thine. And the artist can relate to him because Jesus prayed that prayer. And even after that prayer, he could hear the tinker of armor as one of his own would bring, arrest him and give him the kiss of death. And then in that giant painting, the confrontation scene before the Roman soldiers, we can see the centurion, the commander of the guard. We're told about it in scripture that it was known as a cohort. Jesus at the cohort, a battalion of men, 900, 1,000, 1,200 men. And coming off his horse, the commander would make sport of him. And he would place a blindfold around the eyes of Jesus. After all, they heard about these great tricks and miracles he had performed. And all he had to do at that time was to prove and convince the cohort, the Roman soldiers. And so in front of his own men, he would ask Jesus to play a trick. Come on, Christ. You've been around Judea. You've heard about all these prophets who heal people of leprosy, and then a month later or something, the leprosy comes back. Are you one of those prophets, Christ? Tell my men, because we haven't seen these great tricks. How many of your men have seen one of these tricks that Jesus has played? Just say, Christ, none of them, nor I. Come on, Christ, how was it? Well, you're a young man. You're like the rest of us. You know, Christ, you don't have to go to Herod and be a politician. Tell us about that blind man along the road. They tell us that when he was there, you actually healed him. How did that go, Christ? Hey, Christ, can you see through that blindfold? Come on, Christ, if you're the king, you can see through a mere blindfold. On this side, Christ. Who was it that spit on thee? Was it me? One of my men? Six of them? How many of them are here, Christ? Thy reed, O king. Can you see thy reed? Which way do I hold it, O Christ? Straight up and down? Crossway? Come on, Christ. Speak to us. Play some kind of a trick. Look through the blindfold. On this side, Christ. Who smote thee here? And on that side, and on that side, can't you see? Through a mere piece of cloth, and this foolishness would go on. But Jesus didn't say one word, and they would remove the blindfold and let him go. We'll see what your own will do. And they would release him to the mob at the Praetorium. At that time, they would fashion a crown of thorns. And then, according to law and custom, Jesus would be scourged. Paul spoke about the stripes, 40 stripes minus one, according to the law. In this setting, would the soldiers actually count the 39? Jesus then would be delivered up. He would carry that cross some 800-900 yards to Golgotha, the Hill of Skull, Calvary. And when they got him there, they would crown him with a crown of thorns. And they would crucify him. Oh, the Persians invented it. But the Roman soldiers were quite expert at this. And so then we see these scenes through paintings. We're referred back to it in Scripture, Jesus fulfilling every iota of prophecy. Take him in this condition. They would place him on a cross. They would fix him with nails in a special area in the wrist. They would drive these nails in his wrists, one down below, on a foot, overlapping the other. And Jesus didn't stand on the cross as some art would have. It's like some kind of a king. Jesus, the man, total man, minus one thing that we are all heir to. He didn't sin. And on that cross, they wondered about this one. He couldn't exhale his air. And at that particular moment, Jesus would look up into the heavens and they became dark. He couldn't see the Father anymore. And he would rise, trying to exhale his air in this condition. And they could hear him. Jesus would rise on that fulcrum down below. Father. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. And in the ninth hour, even then he could have been tempted. Come down, Christ, you don't have to go through with this. He would hear the adversary, Satan, spoken about in Isaiah 14:14. Jesus would rise again, and then he knew the Father wasn't there. And in his humanity, he didn't turn divinity on and off. Jesus would look up and shout something that they didn't quite understand. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And at the very end, Jesus would say, but into thy hands I commend my spirit, and he would die. But Jesus, as he promised, came back on the third day, not to be Jesus the crucified, but Jesus Christ the King, as he said he would, raising Lazarus from the dead, healing a woman, healing a blind man, nothing. Jesus came back, and he said he would come back again, the second time. Are we living as if we who call ourselves Christians, as if we believe this? That Jesus had to die this death and the Father would let him go, as he did Ephraim. You're so bent on leaving me, he said in Hosea 10, that I must let you go. And Jesus, the Lamb, took upon himself all the sins of men so that we would be free under grace. If the world of art gives us nothing more than to think about these matters, it will have achieved its grandest goal.